the CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... This is not the ordinary world you have now entered. Our stories are about the unusual, about persons who have had strange experiences, some a little beyond understanding because human understanding is limited. As yet, there is no explanation for such phenomena as specters, extrasensory perception, or a person's retrogression into another century and life. Still, they exist. One night in a bedroom of a large, well-preserved old farmhouse near the base of Mount Rainier in Washington State, an elderly manservant, Andrew Cagey, is speaking to a man in his late 20s.
Nothing's been changed, Mr. Edward. It's a fine room. Sierra dusts once a week. Otherwise, it's closed off. Been that way ever since you left 5 years ago.
I see.
Yeah, better get out of your wet clothes. I'll see about some supper for you.
5 years.
We wondered about you, Mr. Edward. Your aunt said you'd return.
My aunt?
She won't see you, though. Not after what happened.
Mystery story, The Return of Edward Blair, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Roy Windsor and stars John Lithgow. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Control what happens to us? Can we? Leaving the question to philosophers, it does seem that, sometimes at least, what happens to us was beyond our control. Life is unpredictable, meaning perhaps that fate is predetermined, that our life's course is laid out for each of us. The question can be argued, of course, but keep it in mind as the following story unfolds. Told by the young man to whom it happened.
I had quit my job in a logging camp near Mount Rainier in Washington State and was hitchhiking to Seattle. It was a miserable night. I needed shelter. Near Lost Cabin, I saw a light in a farmhouse set back from the road. Good evening. I wonder if...
Mr. Edward. Come in out of the rain. She said you'd return.
Well, thank you. I want to explain.
You're soaked.
I sure am. The heat feels good. I was hitchhiking.
Better get out of them wet clothes. There's dry ones in your bedroom closet.
My bedroom?
Nothing's been changed. Just the way you left it. I'll follow you up. I'll dry out what you're wearing and tell Sarah you've come back. Wild night out there.
There's a crazy mistake.
Yeah, I guess there was, Edward. We never knew. Don't know even now. Every once in a while, Sarah would ask, why did he light out, Andrew? But I had no answer. Neither did Mrs. Blair. You had your reasons, I suppose.
For what, Andrew?
Forgotten where your bedroom is?
You lead the way.
Look the same.
It's a fine room. Just fine.
Miss Blair said to leave it the way it was when you lit out. Sarah keeps it dusted, is about all. It's a nice room. Your desk and your books haven't been touched. Well, you better get out of them wet clothes. I'll take them to the kitchen and dry them out. I'll speak to Sarah about some supper.
I think I'd better see my aunt.
I'm afraid you can't. She won't see you.
Oh.
Well, you know how stubborn she can be, strong-willed. Give her time. She might come around.
Why won't she see me?
You should understand, Edward. Mrs. Blair hasn't been out of the house since you left about 5 years ago this month.
I see.
It gave her a bad shock.
And you?
I didn't believe it. Nobody did. It's 5 years and still hasn't died down. There's still gossip about it.
I see. How did you feel?
Well, kind of let down. I didn't understand you leaving. It did a lot of harm, Edward.
My aunt felt disgraced, is that it?
Of course. Miss Blair is proud of the family name, feels it's her duty to be an example to the rest of us. Everyone looked up to her until you just vanished. And what happened then?
What did happen, Andrew?
I don't want to talk about it. What's done is done. Your aunt doesn't want it discussed.
Well, don't I have a right to know what happened?
You know. Or I'm afraid you'll know soon enough. For now, you've come back.
To what? What do you think?
There's folks in Lost Cabin who'll never forget. Or forgive.
I am not Edward Blair. The nice old man has mistaken me for someone else. I don't know what to do. The storm hasn't abated, and I have shelter and dry clothes for the night. In the morning, I'll insist on seeing Mrs. Blair and telling her the truth.
Sarah's prepared some supper for you, Edward.
Oh, thank you.
Your old clothes fit all right.
They're very comfortable.
I thought you might have put on some weight.
Well, I've tried to stay in shape. I've been glancing through the photo album.
A lot of warm memories there, Edward. Pictures bring them back.
There's a good snapshot of a man on horseback.
Yeah, your Uncle Jack. An impressive gentleman. Killed along with the stallion when they were crushed by a falling tree. You came home from college for the funeral. Right after that, your aunt sold all the timberland, over 500,000 acres, mostly Douglas firs, worth a fortune. All yours. At least, it was all yours.
Now, all that's changed?
I don't know. Hey, if you're ready, come on downstairs.
How does Sarah feel about my return?
Well, you better find out for yourself.
Good to see you, Edward.
Thank you.
Sit down. I'll bring you a plate. Pork chops and home fries and a salad. They used to be your favorite.
Well, it sounds fine. I'm really hungry.
You look all right. Not a day older.
Would you like a bottle of beer? We have some.
Oh, thank you. I would.
I won't be a minute.
That's a sharp steak knife, so be careful. Now, tell us where you've been. Between bites.
Oh, all over.
Oh, tell us about Japan.
Well, I wish I could, but I've never been there.
They said that's where you were heading, folks around here. You said you always wanted to see the Orient.
Your aunt even sent Andrew Trixton up to Seattle to check the steamship line.
Oh, that's too bad.
Where were you? Or don't you want to talk?
Well, I kind of drifted.
That doesn't sound like you, Edward. You always set your mind on something and went after it.
I wanted to acquire experience. I worked on an ore barge out of Duluth and on a farm in Iowa. I went down the Mississippi as a deckhand on a tug.
Why? Oh, that's just common labor. And you with a college degree?
Well, there's nothing wrong with that.
Except you've got a big farm right here, Edward. Not that you ever took to farming. Luke still manages it for us. Got a bumper crop of apples this year and enough wheat to make a profit.
You remember Luke? Oh, he was real mad when you up and left. More upset even than your aunt. Of course, she don't show her feelings. First, she just didn't believe what you'd done. Then she just froze up. You know, that hard look.
Hasn't left the house since.
Not to walk into the village. But she does take walks in the fields once in a while. Sometimes, if it's a nice day, Luke saddles the old mare for her and she rides.
That's a lonely existence.
She was embarrassed.
I caused a lot of trouble. I think I'd better push on in the morning.
Yeah, that might be best.
Oh, I don't see why you shouldn't stay for a few days, Edward. Your aunt might come around. You know, you're all she's got.
No, not Matilda Blair. She won't even talk about it. When Edward left the way he did, he might just as well have died.
I'd like to make amends for whatever I did.
You can't, Edward. You haven't seen her. We have.
You haven't seen her. We have. Who? What had Edward Blair done to become an outcast? My curiosity was aroused. When the old man accompanied me up to my bedroom, I had made up my mind about what I would do.
Well, you're tired out, huh?
I sure am. I walked a long way.
Where from?
I was a lumberjack uprange, about 40 miles away.
You walked from there?
Well, I tried to hitch a ride to Seattle, but it's not a well-traveled road. A few cars went by, but it was foggy, and then it began to rain. No one stopped.
You've been 40 miles away for how long?
About 4 months. I got to hankering for the sea. From Seattle, I was headed for Puget Sound to look for a job on a tanker.
And you decided to stop here?
I needed shelter. There was a light on.
You didn't intend to stop in Lost Cabin?
No.
You're still headed for the sea?
Tomorrow, or the next day. I know I'm not welcome, Andrew. You and Sarah have been kind, but there's a kind of bad feeling here.
I have something for you, Edward. Here.
$100?
I told your aunt you'd returned. She just nodded and pointed to a drawer and told me to open it. The money is for you.
To send me on my way, or to suggest that I stay on?
For a while, maybe. I don't really know. Maybe she wants you to face up to what you did.
I see.
If you stay...
I will. Briefly.
We still have an old mare. You might like to ride the farm.
Oh, thank you.
I think it'd be wiser to avoid the village. It's 5 years, but the folks around here, as you know, they get an opinion stuck in their minds and you can't shake it loose. And their opinion of you isn't good.
You think I could face up to it, to what I did?
If you can explain, maybe. If not, you'd be in danger. You know, Mr. Manning, he's an angry man, and he's taken the law into his hands before.
Manning?
Yeah, still lives on his big estate 5 miles away.
He's the one with the biggest grievance?
That's a foolish question to ask, Edward.
Yeah, I suppose it is. Why have you and Sarah been so kind to me?
We remember the past. You brought us a lot of joy. You were a son to all of us during your grown-up years. And I can't just wipe them out.
I'd better speak to Manning.
No, that I wouldn't advise.
You can imagine how confused I was. Why didn't I just blurt out that I was an imposter, that I wasn't Edward Blair? Well, they didn't give me a chance. Besides, I was offered a bed and a good meal, and I was exhausted. And now I had $100.
Andrew left me, probably to discuss my return with Sarah.
Get him settled, old man?
Yep. He's tuckered out. He's got a lot to think about. He liked the supper.
What did old Sourpuss have to say?
She's been good to us, Sarah.
She wouldn't know what to do without us. He is different, Andrew. Not as high and mighty as he used to be. He'd become quiet, polite.
Scraping for a living can do that.
True enough. Still, he has changed.
Not in appearance. He's a fine-looking young man.
Even the scar has disappeared.
Scar?
Remember when he was 12 or so? He tattooed his name on top of his hand and Mr. Blair had Dr. Ryder take it off?
Oh, I'd forgotten that. That did leave a white patch.
Well, while he ate, I made a point of studying his hand. There is no scar, Andrew.
What brought a young man identified as Edward Blair, who disappeared 5 years before, to the Blair farm? Coincidence? Destiny? I can't answer that because I don't know. Nobody can know. What seems to be coincidence could be fate. We'll see what happens in Act Two. Hopefully, we will learn the narrator's name. We may even learn why he disappeared 5 years ago. Proverb that maintains that he that's born to be hanged needn't fear water. In our kind of story, I often have to fall back on or reach for an explanation of the strange. Just as often I come up empty-handed because sometimes there is no explanation. Certain experiences are unique to the persons who have them. You may doubt them. They do not.
I slept as if I'd been drugged. Andrew mentioned an old mare, so I pulled on riding breeches, and after breakfast, we saddled her, and I trotted off into the sunshiny day.
Good morning.
It was.
Pardon me?
I said it was a good morning.
Ah, so you've come back.
I didn't think you had the guts. You back to stay?
Well, that depends. You're, Luke? Luke Chance?
Who do you think I am, your dead uncle? You crazy or something?
I wasn't certain.
Now, don't tell me you've lost your memory. You can't get away with that, Edward.
Well, it happens.
What, are you serious?
Yeah, in a way.
I don't believe you. Even if I did, I'd never forgive what you did.
Tell me what you think I did.
After you skipped out, I could have killed you because of what happened. You can't explain that away.
I mean to try.
Well, stay away from me. Give me an excuse and I'll hang you up on this pitchfork. I mean it. Now, right off.
What reason have you to hate me?
The entire village hates you. Me? I wish you were dead.
Why?
Steer clear of me or I'll break you in two. Now, right on.
Your sermon, Pastor.
Thank you, Andrew. And you, Mrs. Fitcher?
Oh, yes. Yes. He's back, you know, Pastor.
Yes, I've heard. Has he explained himself?
No, sir.
I see. Does he sorrow?
He seems kind of puzzled, like.
That's a good way to put it, Andrew. Puzzled. Just don't seem to understand what he did. We don't talk about it. Of course, Mrs. Blair said not to.
And we don't want to. There's something unhealthy about her. I'm worried, Pastor.
Yes, so am I.
We try to treat him the way we used to because we remember the good.
But others are not forgiving. And not that we forgive, but we've been trying to forget. No, that's not right, Reverend. We can't forgive what he did. I don't know what I'm saying.
You're a kind man, Andrew. You're torn. You can't forgive, and you can't forget. So, you're trying to suspend judgment. That takes strength. I'll confess something to both of you. I don't think that I have that kind of strength. I see them at least once a week. When I do, the anger comes up in my throat and I can't control it. Have you seen them?
Just once. Even though we're just Mrs. Blair's couple, we weren't welcome.
It was pitiful. One so young and...
I'd advise him to leave Lost Kevin. There's no life for him here. Public opinion is frozen against him. If he stays, he will feel that barrier.
He mentioned wanting to see Mr. Manning.
If he does, he'll cause a real murder. His own.
When Andrew and Sarah returned from the service, I asked Andrew to have a talk with me in my bedroom. He told me what Reverend Lynette had said. My mind was in an ever-tightening vice. I had to speak out.
He's a good man, Edward. Like the rest of us, he was shot.
By what? I demand to know. I don't know what Edward Blair did.
I can't believe that.
Oh, I'm so confused. I'm going crazy.
Then you'd better leave.
Well, I don't want to leave until this is cleared up. It's torture. This silent treatment has got me screaming. Why won't anyone talk to me? Tell me what Edward Blair did, and I'll understand. But this is torture.
Maybe that's your atonement, Edward. The Lord moves in mysterious ways.
What do I have to atone for? You don't believe anything I said, do you?
No. How can you expect me to?
Maybe I have cracked up.
Now I'll speak to your aunt about calling in a doctor. In the meantime, don't sit here and brood. I'll saddle the mare. Get out in the fresh air.
Okay.
Been to the cabin yet?
No.
Seldom used these days, but I keep it tidied up.
Well, all right, this afternoon. First, I have something to do.
Don't go into the village.
Am I some kind of criminal?
Well, we won't go into that.
Did I murder someone?
You did something worse.
Someone would talk. Or was I so damned that everyone would shun me? I wore my own clothes and had my hat pulled down. Except for a few young persons, the streets were empty. I went to the rectory and rang the bell.
Oh.
I'd like to talk to you.
Come in. Follow me. This is my study. Sit down.
Reverend Lynette, what did Edward Blair do?
Ask yourself.
I don't know.
Now, either you are an artful liar, or you have literally lost your mind. Now, I am acquainted with amnesia. If you don't know why you are an outcast, get medical advice elsewhere.
There's nothing the matter with my mind.
There is with your soul.
Look, I was working as a lumberjack about 40 miles from here, and I quit. It was a rainy night.
I have no more time for you, Mr. Blair. Your presence is distasteful to me, and I will not discuss the subject with you.
No one will.
Of course not. Those on whom you inflicted unbearable suffering stand high in this small community. We respect them enough not to discuss what happened.
Then I'll never know what I'm accused of.
Oh, you know the charge, Mr. Blair.
But I don't.
Your return is a shock. Your performance with Mr. and Mrs. Cagey and Luke Chance, and now with me, has been amazing. If Mr. Manning comes looking for you, Mr. Blair, you will recover your memory mighty fast.
I returned to the farmhouse and went for a ride on the mare. It was just as well I did, because later I learned that Mr. Manning had called.
Well,
No, Mr. Manning.
No. Is that the truth? I know he's come home. Now, where is he?
Well, I believe he went riding.
Right, yeah. I'll wait. Now, why was he allowed in the first place?
Well, he just wandered in off the road a few nights ago during the rainstorm. Will you come in?
No. No. But thank you, Andrew. This isn't a social visit. You see this?
A gun will only cause more trouble. And you've had enough, Mr. Manning.
You've seen Liz.
Yes, sir.
I see her every day. Do you think I could forget what Edward Blair did to her?
No. You're welcome to come in.
No. No, thank you. I'll wander around and then wait by my car.
Don't use the gun, Mr. Manning.
No one would testify against me if I did. Goodbye, Andrew.
Goodbye, sir. Sarah.
Who was that at the door?
Mr. Manning. Toting a rifle.
What?
He's got murder in his eye.
Where's Edward?
I don't know. Riding. But where, I don't know. I'm going to slip out the back and try to find him. If Manning knocks again, stall him off.
Andrew, hey, what are you doing half a mile from the house?
Mr. Manning is looking for you. It's worth your life if you return.
Well, is he armed?
You've seen the cabin in the northeast corner of the land?
From a distance? You told me about it.
Well, you better go there and stay for a day or so. Or dismount. I have money with me. And cut out for the state highway. And lose yourself in Seattle. Disappear again. And save yourself.
I'm going to find out what Edward Blair did if it costs me my life. Where's Manning now?
He's waiting for you at the house. When you don't return, he'll begin to search.
If I decide to spend the night at the cabin, is there any way you can inform me about what Manning's doing?
Well, there's a telephone extension from the house to the cabin, but I advise you, for the last time, Edward, not to chance it. Leave by foot. We've had tragedy enough without adding murder to it.
He'd shoot me just like that?
He would.
I certainly did not want to die, but I had to satisfy my curiosity about Edward Blair. So I walked to the cabin and opened the door. I hadn't sat long in the gloom when...
Edward?
What is it? I asked you not to risk coming here.
I brought you some hot soup and a thermos and bread and butter.
Well, thank you.
I thought you might come here, so I watched from an upstairs window. I saw a light through the curtains of the cabin. You're a sitting duck, Edward.
I'm not a common criminal.
That's very true.
And I'm not going to hide like a prairie dog in a hole. And I'm armed.
Yeah, I see that. You're making a grave mistake. For the last time, leave, Edward.
I want to talk to him.
I've warned you. There's nothing more I can say. I'll come down in the morning.
Thank you for the hot soup. And don't worry.
Well, there's nothing more to worry about. I'm resigned.
The course of a person's life is perplexing. If is a two-letter word, but it's a mighty big one. If I had only done this, or if I'd done that. Every day, we make decisions, most of them by instinct. They're like forks in the road that lead sometimes to dead ends or trouble. Edward Blair faces one now. What happens to him will occur in Act 3. I will return shortly.
What
explains a death caused by a falling object, a molding from a building, a limb from a tree. Why was a particular person at the spot at the precise moment to have his life ended? Call it the mystery of life, but try to explain it. About Edward Blair, or the man thought to be Blair, why couldn't he have found shelter for the night at some other farmhouse? Well, it's his story.
After Andrew left me, I was nervous. I'm not all that brave. Later, I learned that he'd sat in the kitchen with his wife, Sarah, and talked about me.
I think I'd better speak to Mrs. Blair. Let her decide.
Decide what?
Is he Edward Blair or a dead ringer for him? He's got me wondering.
The scar on the top of his left hand. Oh, I've wondered about that. Scars just don't disappear.
I'd swear he's Edward. If he isn't, he's identical.
Mm.
What really puzzles me is that he don't seem to know what he did to the Mannings. The real Edward Blair would never forget.
Nor would he ever show his face here again. No, the more I think about it, Andrew, the more I think that this is someone else.
Well, I'm going to find out.
No? It's raining cats and dogs, Andrew.
The man's in danger.
On a night like this?
Yeah, Manning hates him. Weather won't stand in his way. He might kill an innocent man.
Well, use the telephone and tell Edward to come back to the house.
He said he's set on finding out why Edward Blair's hated here worse than sin.
Well, we'll tell him. Of course, my heart breaks about Liz Manning. I must say, at first, I didn't feel too bad about her father. A putty man. He gives himself airs.
I'm sorry for him living in that big house of his and Liz stuck in her room. You saw her, Sarah?
Oh, she's pitiful. Like a faded flower.
Yeah. Worm-eaten. You can see it in her blank eyes. Will we ever be free of it?
No. No, even if this man isn't Edward Blair, Edward is somewhere. And I hope he suffers. Call him, Andrew.
After Andrew telephoned, I turned out the lights in the cabin and drew the screen across the fireplace. As I opened the door...
What the devil?
Just to let you know I'm here, Edward.
Well, you could see I was here. I'm not in hiding.
No longer you ain't.
Well, what do you want?
What I want isn't what I'll get. You're Mr. Manning's pigeon. You haven't got a chance.
I've got a gun, and I know how to use it. Try anything and you'll find out.
Don't tempt me. Where do you think you're going?
Back to the farmhouse.
What for?
To learn the truth.
Learn the truth. What kind of crazy are you, Edward? First, you don't know me. Next, you don't know what you did 5 years ago. You think anyone believes that?
What if it's true? Until I rode up to you in the field, I'd never seen you before.
You're Edward Blair.
So you say.
So does everyone. Andrew, Sarah, Reverend Lynette.
They're mistaken.
We can't be. There's no such thing as identical.
Well, there is now.
And why don't you say who you are and get out of Lost Cabin?
Because I want to find out what Edward Blair did.
You know.
I don't.
You don't know about the engagement and the big party and everyone in town at the church? And what you did?
What did Edward Blair do?
Lit out.
Oh. He left the girl at the altar. Well, that's happened before. Maybe she was well rid of him.
She didn't think so.
And?
I think Mr. Manning ought to force you to see her. First.
And next?
He'll kill you. If he don't, I will.
And one of you will hang.
Don't bet on it. The village will support us. It's an accident, see? happened before.
I want the truth, Andrew. All of it.
What was that gunshot,
Luke?
He fired at you?
A warning. Then he came up to me as I was leaving. He said He said Edward Blair jilted Manning's daughter and disappeared. What happened next?
She turned into a vegetable.
Oh, good Lord.
You might well say that, Edward. If you are Edward.
My name is George Constable. I never heard of Lost Cabin or any of you. I told you the truth. I've drifted everywhere.
Yeah, but when you come to the door that rainy night...
I was wet and cold and broke. I saw no harm in drying out and having a good night's sleep. Then I'd be on my way.
But the next morning...
I don't know. It's hard to explain. It was a fantastic situation. You believing I was the black sheep come home. I wanted to find out what Edward Blair had done. But no one would tell me.
Well, you know now, George.
I'll sit down if you don't mind. Tell me about Manning's daughter.
Well, folks said that Edward, you'd gone to Japan or China or some such in the Orient. We never heard from you again.
Not to this day.
Why? Why did he disappear?
I don't know. Busted his aunt's heart. Ours, too. Then came the disgrace.
It's what happened to Liz. It was a kind of breakdown.
Right in the church, she turned the color of a sheet, and then she crumpled.
That was after waiting an hour for Edward to appear. Andrew and Luke and some other men went looking for him, but he just vanished, like he'd dropped through a hole in the earth.
Manning got her home. Liz, I mean. And a kind of a pall settled over the village.
Oh, she was a beautiful, frail girl.
A lady.
And lots of fine young men had their hearts set on her, but Liz could only see Edward.
Well, she was reserved and retiring. Edward was brash.
Dashing, we used to say. And he loved her. Well, so it appeared.
What happened?
No one knows.
For heaven's sake, there has to be an explanation. Was he kidnapped? Shanghaied? Killed?
We like to think so. That'd explain it.
I can't believe it.
Neither could we. Except for Liz. She's the living reminder of what he did to her.
We've seen her, Sarah and me. Once. She's young. Younger than you. But she's like somebody senile. Blighted. The light's gone out of her eyes.
Thin as a reed. She sits in her room and stares.
A living death.
What if I saw her?
What? Well,
apparently I look exactly like Edward Blair. Yeah, maybe the shock...
Oh, I see what you mean. Maybe seeing you would restore her. Andrew?
It's an idea. Manning's on his way here. I'll go out and... tell him you're not Edward Blair, and then tell him about your suggestion.
Oh, it might be a miracle.
I'll do anything to help.
You really would visit Liz?
I'll give you my word. I meant what I said. I went to my bedroom and changed into dry clothes. I was excited. I thought, be doing something to repay the kind old couple. Then I heard someone. Manning, probably. Knocking at the front door. I listened from the top of the staircase.
Mr. Manning, I have something to say to you.
Where is he?
Mr. Manning, he's not Edward Blair. His name
is... I am coming in, Andrew. Stand back. I don't want you to be hurt.
Please, you're making an awful mistake. His name is George Constable. Sarah and I had the whole story from...
Get back!
He wants to see Liz. Maybe if he does, she'll...
Now, listen, I won't listen to you. If he's upstairs, I'm going up after him. No, I have waited 5 years.
He's just a lookalike. He's a lumberjack from the camp uprange near here.
I'm going upstairs.
You don't have to do that, Mr. Manning. I'm coming down.
It's you, all right.
I want to explain.
Hey, you selfish evil.
Give me a chance to tell you who I am.
What you did to my daughter and to me, this is my revenge.
Mr. Manning.
Oh, good Lord.
You've shot an innocent man.
I shot Edward Blair, and I hope he's dead. He deserved to die.
But he isn't Edward Blair. His name is George Constable. He just wandered in out of the rain.
You're a loyal man, Andrew, but you're soft in the head. Notify the police. Nothing will happen to me. I've done the village a service. Good night.
Oh, I can't believe it.
See if he's alive. I'll telephone the doctor. If he's dead, Manning will be charged with murder.
Get him out of Lost Cabin or I'll finish him off.
May I speak with you inside?
Well, come on. Well?
You shot an innocent man. The sheriff traced him to the logging camp, then to where he worked in Michigan, then to his parents in Illinois. The father will be here tomorrow.
I didn't shoot Edward Blair.
You shot George Constable.
George Constable? Not Blair?
I thought you ought to know.
Then that detestable devil, he's still out there somewhere. I only live to get even with him.
I understand that.
I can be accused of premeditated attempted murder.
Yes. You might say that fate played you a wicked trick.
Some lives seem to be blighted. How else can you explain a lookalike who wanders in out of a rainy night, is mistaken for another, and is shot by a man who hated him? I don't have an explanation. It just happened. Now, what do you think of the two concepts, free will and predetermination? I'll return shortly. George Constable, the young man who looked exactly like Edward Blair, recovered in time from the gunshot. Although Mrs. Blair, the aunt, invited him to stay on, George continued his interrupted journey to the sea. Manning received a suspended sentence. His daughter never recovered. Our cast included John Lithgow, Joan Shea, Robert Dryden, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre.
Until next time, pleasant dreams.